Good morning. It's a joy to see each of you here this morning. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We're here this morning because our God, who has created us and has called us and has saved us, has invited us to worship Him. So we hear from God as we begin our service this morning in the book of John. John chapter 1, starting in verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is God's Word, and because it is true, we can praise and adore him.
Let's be pleased as we sing a wonderful hymn that's been written, How Great Thou Art.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the great.
may be seated.
Amen. Let's go to our God in prayer. Lord, we praise you this morning because of who you are and for what you have done. Even the heavens and the earth declare your glory. And so we come this morning in agreement. Lord, we praise you for all of your goodness to us, how you've demonstrated that through your provision, through your creation, and ultimately through your Son, Jesus Christ. And it's through his blood that we draw near to you this morning. So we pray that all that we do would be glorifying and honoring to you as we draw near to you through the Son of, through the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. As we think about how wonderful God is and all of his goodness demonstrated through creation and ultimately through Christ's death on the cross, we're reminded that we're not that good, that we need his help. More than that, we need his salvation. And so we move into our next song, a song that reminds us that we are sinners and that we have a wonderful Savior. If you haven't been with us before, it's been a little while. We've been working on this song. You'll find the lyrics both on the screen and in the bulletin, He Will Hold Me Fast.
Never give.
great to know the sweet, sweet name of Jesus. You know, I was doing a thing for someone the other day. He says, what are all the songs that talk about how precious Jesus is? The hymn book's got 600 in it. Which one you want to start with? 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. What a friend I have in Jesus. Jesus is the sweetest name I know. What a precious name. And then fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature. Isn't it amazing? Isn't it great that we have this God that we can serve and this Jesus that is our brother and takes us to the throne room of the Father. Isn't that great? Well, let's stand together and sing Fairest Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Terry and choir, for leading us in that congregational singing. Would you take your copy of God's Word and turn to the book of Genesis? Genesis chapter 1. We'll start in verse 1 in just a moment. If you're using the Pew Bible provided there in front of you, it's on page 1. This morning we begin a new sermon series. As you know, it's my habit to walk through books of the Bible, line by line, verse by verse. But for the next 6 weeks, rather than studying the message of one book, I want us to consider the message of the entire book, the big story of the Bible. Now at Rhema, we desire to be a people of the book. Our lives, our church, it's all to be regulated by the book, by the Word of God. We love the book, we know the book, but do we understand it all? We may know lots of stories from the Bible, but do we know the story of the Bible? God has actually given us some tools to help us understand, to tie together the big story of Scripture. But we often miss those tools because they're in the parts of Scripture that we often avoid. Genesis 1 through 3, Revelation 20 through 22 contain many themes that tie together the big story of Scripture. But we often miss out on those themes. When it comes to the book of Genesis, perhaps we think we already know what's going on, and sometimes it can be controversial. When it comes to the book of Revelation, we tend to think that we can't understand what it means, and after all, it's often controversial. But in the first three chapters, in the last three chapters of God's Word, we see many themes, many repeated ideas that tie together the whole story of Scripture. We're going to see gardens and grooms. We'll see trees and clothes. And this morning we're going to see creation and image and rest. And when we notice these repeated themes, these repeated ideas that are found in both Genesis and Revelation and often throughout the Bible, we'll see that neither book is intended to be a mystery that's to be avoided, but rather bookends to be understood. So with all that in mind, we're going to begin this journey by reading all of the first two verses of the book of Genesis, all right? Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Whether in body or in spirit, would you stand with me for the reading of God's Word? Genesis chapter 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And the grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our God stands forever. Let us pray. God in heaven, we thank you that you are a creating God, that you have given us your word, and you've created in many of us new hearts. And we pray today that each of us would be able to say that as we leave, that you created a new heart in us, that each person here would understand what Christ has come to do. We pray you'd help us to set aside all distractions and that we would focus on your word by your Spirit. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. This morning we consider the very good beginning. Now I want you to keep your Bibles open to Genesis chapter 1 because there are going to be times when I'm just pointing out things that are repeated throughout Genesis 1, and as good as Itasca is, she's going to have a hard time keeping up. So I want you to keep your Bibles open as we go through Genesis chapter 1. Well, how does this story begin? It doesn't begin by saying once upon a time or long ago in a galaxy far, far away. The story simply begins in the beginning. In the beginning of what? It's the beginning of our story, but it's not the beginning of God. You see, God has no beginning and no end. Even when we come to the beginning of the book, God is already there. Before anything was, God is. Psalm chapter 90, verse 2 says, before the mountains were brought forth, or even before you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. And we understand that Moses is the author of the first five books of the Bible. This means that he's writing the book of Genesis with a specific audience in mind. He's writing for the children of Israel who have lived for 400 years in Egypt in bondage and slavery. And as God is leading his people out of bondage, out of slavery, into the promised land as his holy nation, Moses is reminding them, this is who we are. This is where we've come from. Notice that Moses does not begin with an apologetic for the existence of God. He doesn't say to the children of Israel, now listen guys, I know we've been in Egypt a long time. We've seen lots of options for who God is. Here in Egypt, we've got Apis, the bull god. We've got Isis, the goddess of the Nile. We've got Re, the sun god, just to name a few. Moses doesn't begin by disproving these gods. He doesn't say, guys, I want to tell you about the one true and living God. I want to tell you about the God who revealed himself to me in the burning bush, who revealed his name as I am. And so in order for me to tell you about him, I must first disprove these other gods. He doesn't say, I want to remind you that you ought to throw Isis back in the river and that you need to send Ray to the moon. And I want to remind you that Apis is just a whole bunch of bull. That's not how Moses begins. He doesn't give a defense of God. He simply declares the reality of God and lets God defend himself. In the beginning, God. You see, Moses agrees with David in Psalm 14 when David wrote, "The fool has said in his heart, there is no God." Moses does not debate the atheist or entertain the agnostic. He merely acknowledges the obvious. Paul tells us in Romans 1 how obvious it is that there is a God in heaven who rules over all things. Romans chapter 1 verses 18 through 20 say, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power, his divine nature, they have been clearly perceived." Anyone can look around and see these things. "Ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made. So they are without excuse." Now, I'm not saying that there's never a time to debate an atheist or to have a conversation with an agnostic, but I do want you to see where Moses begins. Moses begins simply by saying, "In the beginning, God." To understand who we are, to understand the way the world is supposed to be and the way the world actually is, we have to begin where the Bible begins. In the beginning, God. But we go to that next word there in verse 1, and we see something amazing, something that we have to wrap our minds around. We must understand that God created. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, the Hebrew word that Moses uses here for created is always used in reference to God alone. Only God can create this way. As we'll see in a few minutes, human beings are created in the image of God, which means at least in part that because God creates, we can create. Some of you are very creative people. I've seen your work. But even the most creative among you must have materials to work with. You have to have something to build out of. God created out of nothing. He didn't have a build the universe kit that he bought from Amazon. He didn't turn to Etsy for inspiration. He didn't look up a step-by-step instruction video on YouTube. The creator of all things created everything out of nothing. But in the beginning, the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. God made the earth, but he had not yet formed it. He had not yet filled it. The substance was there, but it was incomplete. We're about to see the creation, but notice that even here in verse 2, there's an expectation. Because when you look at the end of the verse 2, it says, "And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters." Now we understand that God the Father is busy working in creation. Now we're told in verse 2, at the end of it, that the Spirit too is involved in creation. And you need to understand right from the beginning that the Son was involved as well. Paul tells us in Colossians chapter 1, "For by him," that is Jesus, "all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him." Our triune God is also a creating God. There are three themes that I want us to see this morning in the very good beginning. The first of these themes that I want us to see is simply the theme of creation. Creation. Beginning in verse 3, we see the day-by-day work of the Creator. There are 6 days of creative activity, and there's a certain rhythm to how Moses describes each day. Each day begins with God speaking a command. And without fail, God's word is obeyed. God approves of his creation, and the day is summarized with the same phrase, and there was evening, and there was morning, the first day, the second day, and so on. There's a certain rhythm to how God creates. You'll see that as you read through chapter 1. But not only is there a rhythm to how God creates, but there's also a symmetry to how God creates. You might say that on the first 3 days, God forms the earth, and on the next 3 days, God fills the earth. He forms and he fills. You see, on day 1, God makes light and darkness. And on day 4, God fills the light and the darkness with the sun and the moon and the stars. On day 2, God makes the sky and the waters. And on day 5, God fills the skies and the waters. And on day 6, on day 3, God makes the land and the seas and the vegetation. And on day 6, he fills the land and the sea with animals and humanity. God forms and he fills. This is what God is doing, but how does God do this? How does God create? How does God bring order out of nothingness? How does God form and fill? By his word. Now let's look at it. This is one of the places where I want you to keep your Bible open. Look with me here. Day 1 begins in verse 3. The beginning of the verse says, "And God said." Day 2 begins in verse 6. "And God said." Day 3 begins in verse 11. "And God said." On all 6 days of creation, the creative power is simply the voice of God. God speaks, and all of creation listens and obeys. As you read through the account of each day of creation, you see that God's commands are effective. They work. 6 times we have the refrain, "And it was so." God speaks, he commands, and it was so. It happens. In creation, God speaks and his word is effective, but God also sees his creation. Look at verse 4. "God saw that the light was good." Day by day, God speaks and God sees. What does God see? Look at verse 10. "God saw that it was good." Look at verse 12. "God saw that it was good." Again and again and again, verses 18, verse 21, verse 25, "God saw that it was good." And when God comes to the end of day 6, in verse 31, what is God's verdict? "God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good." This is the very good beginning. But is this what we see when we look around us today? Perhaps there are places in the world that if we could just drop you off and put you wherever you wanted to go, you would say, "Now this is very good." Perhaps if we took you to Hawaii and just dropped you in a beautiful part of Hawaii, you would say, this is very good. My family enjoys watching Wheel of Fortune, and every show it seems like somebody is going to Aruba, Jamaica, or someplace they want to take you. And so there's places that you go in the earth, maybe it's the beautiful parts of Ireland where everything's green all the time. There are different parts of the earth that we would go and we would say, "This is very good." But part of the reason that we know that this is very good is because we know that there are parts of the world that aren't very good. None of us look at the landfill and say, "This is very good." None of us look at the junkyard and say, "This is very good." Now, we're still in chapter 1. Eventually, we'll get to chapter 3 in 2 weeks. Chapter 3 is going to explain what went wrong. But even now, we look around at the world that we're in and we say, this is not very good. This is not the same. Well, Paul explains this so well to us in Romans chapter 8. Listen to Romans chapter 8. Our brother Paul tells us, "For I consider the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. Listen, for we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. Not only the creation, but we ourselves." Creation itself, the heavens and the earth, are so far removed from their very good beginning. And they're longing for redemption. They're groaning for redemption. But not only creation, we ourselves too. Why is that? Well, to better understand that, let's move to our second theme in the very good beginning. Let's look at the theme of image. Go to chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. Chapter 1, verses 26 and 27. Something very important happened on the sixth day of creation. Verse 26 says, "Then God said, 'Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth.'" So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God has done amazing things in these 6 days, but he's not done. He's created light and darkness, but he's not done. He's created the oceans and the skies, but still he's not done. He's created the sun and the moon and the stars and the seasons, but still he's not done. Verse 21 tells us that God created the great sea creatures, every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was very good, that it was good. God has filled the oceans and the skies with creatures, but he's still not done. Well, what about the land? Verse 25 tells us, "God made the beast of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the earth according to its kind. And God saw that it was good, but he's not done." The apex, the pinnacle of creation, the shining crown of his work is humanity. And as we'll see next Sunday, out of the dust of the earth, God doesn't just speak humanity into existence, but he carefully forms and fashions human beings. God begins with the first man, Adam. What makes human beings special? Well, God said there back in verses 26 and 27, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness." This introduces us to the theme of image that we see throughout Scripture. Humans are made in the image of God. But what exactly does that mean? Well, notice first that this is an act of the entire Godhead. Because up until now, God has just said, "Let there be this and let there be that." But now God says, "Let us make." That seems important. And as New Testament Christians, we're quick to read the Trinity into this. And I've already pointed out to you that our triune God, Father, Son, and Spirit, is working in creation. But perhaps this one verse is a little bit too much to ask it to support the entire doctrine of the Trinity. But as New Testament Christians, when we look back through the shadows of the Old Testament, we can see that our God is working here, Father, Son, and Spirit. God makes man in his own image. This is one of those biblical ideas that we can never fully exhaust. What does it mean to be made in the image of God, to be made in his likeness? Well, in some way, The first man and the soon to come first woman are like God in some ways. They resemble Him and they represent Him. So we can be moral, we can be creative, we can be self-conscious, we can be thoughtful, rational, emotional creatures because God has made us in His image, in His likeness. But it gets even better. Look at verse 28. And God blessed them. Humanity's made in God's image. They have God's blessing. And now God says to them, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth. Our parents in the garden were made in the image of God. And they had God's blessing on them, and they had delegated authority from God. And just as God had already told the animals to be fruitful and to multiply, now God tells humanity to be fruitful and multiply. He tells humans to have dominion, to rule over, to subdue all the animals of the earth. Now, the first humans, they also have the provision of God. We see this in verse 29. Look at chapter 1, verse 29. And God said, behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. And God saw everything that He had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. What a very good beginning. God has given them everything that they need to flourish. They have the blessing of God clearly on their lives. They can see God's blessing in a tangible way. Every time they reach out to grab a piece of fruit from the tree to eat from it, they know that they have God's blessing and God's provision on their lives. And now God has seen all of His creation and He has declared that it is very good. But yet again, we know that something is not quite the same for His image bearers today. Now, I want to be absolutely clear. Every man, woman, boy, girl, red, yellow, black, and white, every person is made in the image of God. But that image is marred. It's not destroyed, but it is defaced. Because of Adam's sin, each of us are born with a deformed image of God upon us. Because we don't rightly represent and resemble our Creator. Something went horribly wrong in the garden. The next time the idea of image is mentioned in the book of Genesis, it's in Genesis chapter 5, verse 3, which says, when Adam had lived 130 years, he fathered a son in his own likeness after his image and named him Seth. Adam has a son in his own image and he names him Seth, but for those of you who are familiar with the story of Genesis, you know that we've skipped two sons. Cain and Abel have already been born and are now dead by the time we get to chapter 5. They're both made in the image of their father Adam, but they didn't make it very long. Every son of Adam and daughter of Eve that has ever been born or will be born will fail to rightly bear the image of God, just like our father and mother failed in the garden. Now, things get so bad after this very good beginning that God actually instates capital punishment, which, by the way, He has never revoked. Genesis chapter 9, verse 6 says, whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in His own image. This matter of the image of God, it's very serious. We'll return to it in a moment, but we still have more to see in the very good beginning. Now, even as chapter 1 comes to an end, I told you we were going to look at chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, but, you know, these chapter divisions were added a long time ago, and they weren't inspired by God. We're thankful for them, It makes it a lot easier when I tell you where to turn to in the Bible, but just because it says chapter 2 begins right here, that doesn't mean it's the most helpful place for chapter 2 to begin. We actually need to see the first three verses of chapter 2 to understand the whole story of creation. So look at chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day God finished his work that he had done. He rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it God rested from all his work that he had done in creation. Do you hear the third theme in those verses? The third theme that I want us to consider is rest. Rest. We often focus on the 6 days of creation, but the story is incomplete until the seventh day. On the seventh day, God rested. He finished. He had work to do, and he completed it. Now he has given Adam work to do. Adam is to be fruitful and to multiply. He's to subdue the earth and to have dominion over the earth. And day 7 sets that trajectory for Adam and all who come after Adam, that if you fulfill the work that the Creator has given you, then hopefully one day you too will enter into that rest. And just to be clear, God is not resting because he's tired. He rests because he has finished. He has completed his work. And it seems possible that here, in the very good beginning, that the image bearer, Adam, will one day be able to actually complete this work and rest like his Creator. But of course, we know that Adam fails. Adam fails to rightly mirror the image of his Creator. Adam fails to subdue the earth. Adam fails to have dominion over the earth. He fails to enter the rest that God has prepared for him. And as we go throughout the Old Testament, we see that no one is able to lead God's people into their promised rest. Noah is not able. Even after this idea of Sabbath rest is introduced into the Ten Commandments, it's codified, it's put into law for the nation of Israel in the Ten Commandments, even then they still fail to keep their Sabbath rest. Nancy Guthrie compared this idea to that wedding gift that you get that you don't think you need and you don't want and you want to give back. That's how Israel treated the gift of Sabbath rest. They didn't think they needed it. They didn't want it. And so they wanted to give it back. As you keep reading through the Old Testament, you see that according to the prophets, that the abuse of the Sabbath rest that God had given them is actually one of the capital charges that God has against his people. So the only hope for all of us sons and daughters of Adam is for a second Adam to come and make it possible for us to enter into our Sabbath rest. You see, Genesis 1 tells us of a very good beginning. But if we actually don't know the big story of Scripture, then Genesis 1 is bad news. Because it's not the very good beginning, it's just a terrible tease. Because we know that we're not in the garden, and we can't get back to the garden on our own. But I have good news. The true Creator is also the true image bearer. The first Adam failed to rightly bear the image of God, but the second Adam, Jesus Christ, he is the image of the invisible God. So you need to understand this morning that every one of us is born with a sin nature that we have inherited from our father Adam. We were born with the marred and deformed image of God upon us because of our sinful inclinations, our sinful tendencies, and if we're left to ourselves, we will squander the good creation that God has given us just like Adam. We waste God's provisions. We fail his commands. And we groan right along with creation. But even as creation longs for redemption, Scripture tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, that if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Look, he's making all things new. How is this possible? Because the God who created us came to earth to save us. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the second member of the Trinity, he comes to earth. He doesn't leave behind his godness. He continues to always be God, but he takes on the form of a human. He becomes fully God and fully man, and he lives the life that you and I cannot live. He exercises dominion where Adam failed. Those of you who are in our community Bible study, you've seen this week, that Jesus perfectly exercised dominion over all of creation. Jesus has power over disease, disaster, demons, and death. Jesus is faithful where Adam failed. Jesus lived the perfect life that you and I could not live and that Adam could not live. And so Jesus took the death, the punishment that you and I deserve. And as he hung on that cross, he said, "It is finished." His atoning work was done. He was laid in a borrowed tomb and he rested. And on the third day, he burst forth from the tomb. He lives victorious forevermore. He's ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he's continuing to do this work on our behalf so that we can actually have it better than Eden. Christ was perfectly faithful where Adam failed. Apart from Christ, your life is without form and void. You have no order in your life. Your life is only chaos, just like creation was. Apart from Christ, you can find no rest. But this morning, the Creator, the true image bearer, he calls out to you saying, "Come to me, all you who are labor and who are heavy laden, who are weary, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. You will find rest for your souls." The author of Hebrews is clear. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 9 and 10 say, "So then there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his." True rest is found in Christ alone. So would you cease from your vain attempts, your vain labors this morning? Stop trying to stand in your own righteousness and look to Christ. Repent of your sins and simply trust Christ. The image of God may be severely deformed in your life, but Christ makes all things new. Here's the really good news. You don't have to wait until the very good ending, until the image of God begins to be restored in your life. Romans chapter 8, verse 29 tells us that day by day, the Holy Spirit is working to conform all who are in Christ into the image of Christ. He's restoring us day by day. 2 Corinthians 3:18 tells us that as we behold the glory of the Lord, we are being transformed into the same image, the image of God, from one degree of glory to another degree of glory. For those of us who are in Christ, who have been saved by the Creator of the world, are you still finding your rest in Christ? Are you looking elsewhere? Do you find rest in the pleasures of this life while neglecting the commands that Christ has given you? Dear brother or sister, repent. Enjoy every good gift that is from above, but find your rest, your peace, your joy, your fulfillment, your purpose, your identity in Christ. Are you consumed by grief today? Grief, perhaps over poor decisions in the past, bad choices that you've made. Grief over the loss of a loved one. Are you seeking comfort? Are you seeking rest in Christ or in the things of this world? Are you looking for something extraordinary to jumpstart your spiritual life? You know that things aren't what you want them to be with Christ. You're looking to grow in your spiritual life, and you're just waiting for lightning to zap you. You're just waiting for something special to happen to jumpstart your spiritual life. Do you remember how God created on all 6 days? By His Word. God works through His Word. And even as the Spirit hovered over the waters, the Spirit of God indwells all who are in Christ. And the Spirit glorifies the living Word, Christ Jesus, and helps us understand His written Word. So do you magnify the Word in your life? And if not, why not? Repent, dear Christian. Treasure God's word more than you treasure the food that you eat, because truly, these are the words of life. God works through His word and by His Spirit. Are you fearful over the state of creation? Do you spend more time saying, "This is not very good," rather than looking to the very good Creator? Dear friend, repent. Spend less time consuming the news and more time consuming the Word. Spend less time caving in fear and more time cultivating faith. And if you wonder whether or not your pastor has to preach the sermon to himself before he can preach it to you, the answer is yes. But as we come to the conclusion of this sermon, the very good beginning, I want all of us who are in Christ to take courage and remember that this is our Father's world. Let us never forget that though the wrong seems off so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is our Father's world, and the battle is not done. Jesus, who died, will be satisfied, and heaven and earth will be one. Even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. Amen and amen. Before we sing our hymn of response, I want to give you the opportunity to respond in your heart. So we're going to have just a few moments of silence for you to reflect on God's word and to hear what God's Spirit is urging you to do. Then I'm going to pray for us all that we, myself included, would be obedient to the will of our Creator. Let's bow our hearts before the Lord. Our Creator God, we have heard your word. Now would you give us ears to hear and feet that obey? Would you make clear to each one of us how we are to respond to your word? And draw all of us unto yourself. For your glory we pray. Amen. In just a moment, we're going to sing our hymn of response. And if you need to continue praying in your seats, you're welcome to do that. If you need to pray down front, you're welcome to do that as well. I will be here, and I would be glad to pray with you, to talk to you further about what it means to trust Jesus. And I'd be glad to do that after the service as well. Would you sing our hymn of response?
Would you stand with me, please? I need thee.
Thank you, and you may be seated. As our ushers are coming forward, be reminded that this is the opportunity to give back out of the many wonderful gifts that God has blessed us with. Will you pray?
Father, once again, we thank you for the opportunity that you have given us to come in your house today, Lord. We thank you for the beautiful way you brought us. We thank you for the message that Brother Charles brought us today, Lord. We pray that you teach each heart, and if we are lost one here today, that they would come to know you before it's too late. We ask you now to take this time and offer the meetings your honor and glory. In Christ's name, amen.
Our chorus for the next couple of weeks in offering time is from Psalm 119, 105. Thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my path. And is joined with Psalm 56, 3 and 4. When I'm afraid, I will trust in you. I will not fear what man can do to me. Let's sing. So if you know it, sing it with me. Thy word.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. And nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and a light unto my path, and a light unto my path.
As God commissions us to go out into this world to serve Him, I want to make you aware of a few announcements. But first, I want to welcome our guest. For those of you who are here, this is your first time or maybe a long time since you've been to Rhema, I would invite you. You'll see some green cards there in front of you. Fill that out. Give me your information. If you want to be followed up on, I'm going to try to follow up one way or the other, so it would make it a whole lot easier if you just give me something to go on so that I can tell you how glad we are that you're here today. And you'll have an opportunity as you leave just to pass that to me so that I could let you know how thankful we are that you're here today. As far as announcements go, for those of you who are going on the Ark Encounter trip, the Creation Museum trip, we really need your balance due by next Sunday. If you're not sure how much that is, or if you've got some issues with that, just let Lindsay know. We want to try to go ahead and get that done so we can get the tickets for the Ark Encounter and the museum bought and all that good stuff. So balance due on that next Sunday. Coming up soon, let's see, October 26th, the ladies are going to have their monthly fellowship lunch. So if you'll look at that, it's on the Tuesday after the women's Bible study. All women are invited to go, even if you're not part of the Bible study, but that's when they're going to go to lunch. There's a sign-up sheet in the foyer for that, just so that they can know how many to make the reservation for. It's that time of year as we're getting ready to pack our Thanksgiving food baskets. You know that we have the monthly food bag ministry that we have here at the church. At Thanksgiving, Thanksgiving and Christmas, we try to do a little bit more to make sure that the families in the area that are receiving those gifts are able to have a little bit extra at this time of year. So there's, in the foyer, there's a list of items that you could donate. If you'd be willing to do that, that would be really helpful. You can leave the donations there in the box there in front of the piano, and the due date for that is November 14th, because we'll need a little bit of time to get all that packed up before we give them out on November 20th. We're doing the Christmas backpacks as well. Those are in the foyer. Linda or Barbara will be happy to talk to you more about that and what we're looking for to fill those backpacks with, and if you have any questions about that, you can ask them. This Tuesday night, men's Bible study again. This gets us back on track, so we've got 2 weeks in a row. Tuesday night, 6:30, downstairs in the fellowship hall. Even if you haven't joined us before, now's a great time to come and be with us and study God's Word. This Wednesday night is a normal Wednesday night, but that doesn't mean you shouldn't come if you think normal is not exciting. We get to go before our Heavenly Father and pray as the body of Christ. And so I would encourage you to come and be a part of that this Wednesday night at 6 p.m. And then following after that, 7 p.m. choir rehearsal here in the sanctuary. And last but not least, we do have a monthly church conference. Now that is open to absolutely everybody. There's nothing that we're trying to hide or keep private, but some of you are looking for the door. I understand that. And so we're about to sing a song, and I'm going to go to the door, and I would love to just say hello to those of you who are ready to leave, and then in just a moment, we will have our church conference.
A closer walk with thee.
I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong.
Since it's family chat time, I'm going to share something with you while the preacher's coming. Today is a very, very special weekend for Teresa and myself. 20 years ago, at this time, we were in the hospital experiencing breast cancer. And she's a 20-year, I don't think survivor is not a good enough word for it. She's a 20-year, I don't know if it's victory, I don't know what word you call it, but 20 years ago, God chose to put us through that. He's blessed us to give us health, and we're eternally grateful for that. Do I want to go through it again? Nope, neither does she. But if it came along, we'd do it again. I would be there beside her. So you, thank you for letting me share that with you. It is a very important thing to honor what God has done in your life and this one of them for us. All right, Pastor, your turn.
He who is blessed and the only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see, to him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. Go in peace.